right. Hi, everybody. Welcome. Thanks for coming. I'm Dr. Bagley. I know most of you guys. Again, thanks for being here to our fourth muscle physiology lecture series. We've got some good guests here. I just want to take a minute to acknowledge the Rossi Foundation, the Rossi Family Foundation, and the Department of Kinesiology for sponsoring this event. So thanks to them. And now I'm going to have Taylor Valentino come up and introduce our first speaker.
All right, intro for the intro. All right, our very first speaker is Dr. Annie Galpin. Dr. Galpin is a professor in the Center of Sports Performance at Cal State Fullerton. He holds a PhD in human bioenergetics from Ball State. He is the founder and the director of the Biochemistry and Molecular Exercise Lab, where he studies human muscle at the whole level, all the way down to the individual genes to investigate acute responses to chronic, acute responses and chronic adaptations to high power intensity exercise. He was a frequent guest on Barbell Shrugged and now is a co-host. And you can also find him on andygalpin.com. So we'll just give a big round of applause for Dr. Annie Galpin.
At 8:31 a.m. on August 16th, 2016, a scrappy little tomboy from Maryland shocked the world when she beat 16-time defending, three-time defending Olympic champion Sayori Yoshida and became the first American to ever win a gold medal in women's wrestling. Interestingly, about a month later, at the 67th International Astronautical Congress in Guadalajara, Mexico, a young billionaire shocked the world when he announced he's taking all of us to Mars. What's really interesting about both of these events, whether we're trying to describe outstanding athletic performance, we're constantly asking questions like how much of Helen's gold medal was she born with versus how much did she train for? Or if we're trying to get to Mars and we're taking a ride in the Dragon, the fundamental question we're really asking is, what makes muscle grow, what makes it die, what makes it repair? It's the same concept that's going to get us to Mars that gets Helen to a gold medal. In my lab, in Irene and I's lab, we choose to answer that question by studying the muscle one individual fiber at a time. And so you can see we take muscle biopsies from real-life humans with that tiny little instrument right there. You can see the actual some of the tissue right there. You can actually see Dr. Bagley processing the tissue over there, kind of lining it up so that we can play with it later. What that allows us to do is to go in with the microscope, and you can see right here I've dyed that bundle of fibers green, and right there is me isolating two individual muscle fibers. I'll separate them right there so that you can see a little bit better. Now, if I were to pick that up, and you'll see in a slide here, you could see that with your naked eye, depending on the lighting. In fact, I actually don't do that anymore. My students do all that. I haven't been underneath that microscope in probably 5 years. Right? That's what I have grad students for, and undergrads. And so what we wanted to talk to you guys today about are the cellular and molecular mechanisms underpinning muscle performance. And just to share with you a little bit about the way we're trying to answer that question, because it's a very big question, and we can only answer so many, there's so many parts of that question at once. So that's kind of where we're going today. I'll be a little bit broad and a little bit short, and I'll leave all the real lifting to Dr. Tobias when she comes up. So let's get started. One of the things that we realized very quickly in our lab is that the function of the individual cell predicts the function of the whole body, which is a way of saying how your individual muscle fibers perform determines how you will actually perform, which is why we, again, started to study performance at this individual fiber level. But we also have to realize that not all fibers are created to perform equally. And this is where we get our classic slow-twitch muscle fibers, fast-twitch muscle fibers. And so we realized that, and then we started to realize, okay, if we start studying individual cells, a fiber and a cell, by the way, it's synonymous, it's the same thing. So in human muscle, one fiber is one cell, which is pretty unique. But when we started to try to understand human performance, and there you go, by the way, that's one individual muscle fiber. It's being picked up from the dish. That's how big they are. We can categorize these as fast twitch or slow twitch, but it gets a little bit more involved than that. In fact, we realize we've got our slow twitch at the end, and some of you may have learned red fibers, white fibers. This is kind of where we get it started. Well, now we also realize there are ultra-fast fibers. And more importantly, there are even fibers that sit in between. So what you're looking at here is one individual cell. That's one individual fiber that is part fast and part slow. It's a combo, or what we call a hybrid fiber. Just like you call your car that's half gas, half electric, a hybrid car, right? It's the same thing. And we even have some that are on this end of the spectrum that are half fast, half ultra fast. And so as we began to understand this concept more and more, we started to realize what's actually happening is our fibers just really exist on a big continuum. There are those that are the slowest that have the best endurance, and there are those that are the fastest that have the least endurance. And so when we started to try to pin this down to performance, one of the things that we started to realize, and others have realized for us, is if I lay you a little compass, and on the far right-hand side means you have more fast twitch, on the far left you have more slow, and then we put our hybrids in the middle, again, less and more, what we realize are things like, hey, a competitive sprinter probably has more fast than slow. I don't think I shocked anybody in the room with that, right? A distance runner probably has more slow, and we're probably there in the spectrum. But what got interesting is when we started to realize, when we look at sedentary or just fairly minimally active people, what's shocking is the amount of hybrids they have. And when we started looking at other groups and populations, you know, decent runners, soccer players, athletes, the overall understanding was the more active you are, regardless of your activity style, the less hybrids you had. The more inactive, the more you get. And in addition, depending on how your activity goes, you may have more fast or you may have more slow. And so we know very, very easily and very convincingly that there is a direct relationship between fiber type composition and actual exercise performance. The question then becomes, okay, all right, were they just born with it? That's why they run well? That's why they lift a lot? Or is this a result of their training? And I'm not sure what some of you have heard before, but we're still struggling with this idea. People are still debating it somehow, when in fact we know there is an extremely clear answer. It's beyond debatable. One of the other things we started to realize is, what about strength and power athletes? You may not realize, but we have almost no information at all about something as simple as fiber type of strength and power athletes. Now, we would predict them to be over here, right? But we haven't done it yet. Those data don't really exist. I'm fortunate enough to work with a lot of MMA fighters. And I got really interested in working with these populations because I started to realize they have got to be very strong, but they also have to be able to fight as hard as they possibly can for 25 minutes. And if you ever wrestle with your friend, maybe after some tequila, maybe not, and you wrestle for like 25 seconds and you're gassed, like beyond belief, try to do that against a professional killer for 25 minutes, right? And so I realized, like, man, they have got to be unbelievably strong, and yet they have to be super fit. So what are they going to be? Are they going to be fast or slow? We don't know. And so we started to take biopsies of this population, and here's what we found. Now, let me walk you through the chart. So remember, the 1s are the slow, 2x are super fast, and a 2a, 2x is a hybrid, and a 1, 2a is a slow, fast hybrid, right? And if we look at sedentary or untrained or recreationally active people, you can see the basic numbers of each. And so when we looked at a pretty high level, this is a top 10 ranked UFC fighter, we found him to be pretty much the same in terms of his slow twitch. Right? He was only about 30% or so slow twitch. But he was pretty fast. And then what's very interesting is his VO2 max was as high or as higher of any endurance athlete you'd predict. Right? So he had some combination of an unbelievably fast fiber type, but yet had the ability to perform at an extremely high endurance level. What's also interesting is you see, again, he's got very few of the hybrids, whether they're fast, mega fast, or slow fast. And so when we come back to our compass here, we're trying to identify what's going on. Well, I don't really know. And what it really made me think about is, what about concurrently trained athletes? Now, if you don't know what that term means, it refers to anybody who does a combination of lifting and endurance activity. How many of you do a combination of lifting and endurance? Keep your hands up. That's the vast majority of the room, right? Almost all of you do a combination because we know that's what we should do for health, right, and weight loss or weight management, but yet we have no idea what that actually causes your muscle to change to or not. So it's a very interesting question, and Dr. Tobias is going to talk a lot more about that. In fact, she's going to center a lot of her presentation on the molecular consequences of that type of activity, what we found recently. And so then, of course, we want to identify, all right, here's your fiber type, but does it actually change in response to your training? Well, this is actually a wonderful chart from Dr. Bagley, and so I'll steal all of his good work and act like it's mine. But I think it's quite evident. I'm not going to walk you through this whole thing because it doesn't matter, but look at the bar graphs. This is the amount of change in fiber type in response to a bunch of different things. 177 days of space flight, 60 days of bed rest, I mean, you name it, right? It's just not questionable whether or not these fiber types change. They absolutely do. So then some are going to ask, okay, well, how much? Like, well, wait, are we talking 2% or 800%? And so we don't have an exact number, but what's interesting is a recent paper came out, not in humans, but in primates, that showed fiber type changes in responses to high-fat, high-sugar diets. So not only can you change your fiber type with your workouts, your diet can alter your fiber type. They also gave one of these groups resveratrol, the phytochemical, and found that also influenced fiber type change. Your diet matters, folks. Just because you lift, I run 60 miles a week, it matters. So not only does it changes in response to a lot of different things. And in fact, a really cool paper, it looks a bit jumbly here, but let me walk you through it. It's not that difficult. Young people, old people, slow twitch, fast twitch, pre and post, right? We see a clear increase in the amount of slow twitch post, and the same thing in the old people, right? Because of that, we see a consummate decrease in the fast twitch and a decrease in the fast twitch. Everyone follow me there? What's crazy is what they did to cause that fiber type change. They had them not do anything for 14 days. Take that two-week vacation, you get horizontal on a beach drinking Mai Tais for 2 weeks. That's enough. That'll do it. Fast twitch goes down. Slow twitch goes up. And then, really interestingly, they came back and said, well, what if we follow them for the next month and we have them get back into active recovery, 28 days of active recovery, and we see the exact opposite thing happening, right? So basically, you don't need to follow the numbers too well, but you can see it's just an inverse, right? Whatever happened from the disuse got reversed from the 28 days. So the implications to spaceflight, trying to get to Mars, boy, this is going to be a real issue, right? But also the implication to, I haven't worked out. I used to work out in high school. I'm good. No. That's a lot more than 14 days, right? That's 10 years or whatever. Your lifestyle matters. Your decisions with training, your decisions with food, all matters. So to bring you up to speed here to kind of give you some conclusions so far, come on in. No problem. Number one, we know that there's a direct relationship between muscle performance and cellular function. It's not 100%. There are many other factors. You've got connective tissue, ligament, you've got bone, you've got biomechanics, you've got neural. So there are many other factors, but this is a very significant factor. And number two, the amount of plasticity, which is a fancy way of saying the amount of your ability to change, that's actually greater than we previously thought. So you have more input on the way your body performs than we've ever thought before. That led us down the road of saying, okay, if this is happening, what's actually physically regulating that plasticity? Well, to give you a very quick overview of molecular biology, if you imagine this to be one muscle fiber, this whole brown thing, and you imagine this to be your nucleus, which is where you hold your DNA, and these little balls are your genes, and these little pink-ish fuchsia, maybe, I'm not good at colors. What do we got here? Fuchsia? Yeah, good. My wife will be happy about that. You got your colors, good. And we imagine those just to be random amino acids. Okay. Well, how your cells work is something happens at your cell wall, call it exercise, call it diet, you name it, and it activates a little protein. That protein activates that protein, activates that one, and then one of them directly talks to the nucleus and tells it what happened. We've been damaged, we have an excess amount of carbohydrate, or whatever happens to be. We call those signaling proteins. So Dr. Tobias is going to talk a lot about these in her talks, and that's what she's referring to, these collective group of proteins that communicate with the nucleus and tell your cell what the hell just happened. And then the nucleus can decide what it's going to do about it. Right? That decision to do about it is what's called gene expression. So you're all born with a certain set of DNA that does not change, right? But the way your DNA is expressed is directly influenced by your physical activity, by your smoking habits, by your diet. In fact, what we now know is not only do you not change your DNA, but you decide which ones to express. So say imagine you've got four DNA that you can code for four different proteins. Well, maybe you train, you do a really hard lifting bout, and maybe it turns on this guy here that activates a protein to build muscle. But it doesn't activate this one or this one or that one. That's what we mean when it decides which ones to express. We also know that your diet and other lifestyle habits not only influence the way you express your own genes, but that is inheritable in your offspring. So we find changes, not we, but others have found changes in sperm of people who go on exercise who weren't previously exercising. And then that is inherited in the offspring. So if you haven't believed me yet that your lifestyle choices change your life, they certainly are going to change your offsprings. All right, that's gene expression. If, for example, we did that, we said we went over to your wonderful weight room over here. We're working on that, right? Right, Doc? And we got a good bout of lifting in. We had sufficient amount of amino acids in our cell already, which means we had to have protein in the last handful of hours or something, half a day or something. And we had sufficient energy. What would happen is these signaling molecules would tell your nucleus, hey, we've gotten some damage. We've been overwhelmed. It doesn't have to be damage. It could be, though. We need to start expressing genes. And if this particular thing over here is a myosin filament, which is the big filament that causes your muscles to contract, what's going to happen is your DNA is going to say, okay, express the DNA to code the proteins and start adding to it. And that process is protein synthesis. Okay, we're not going to talk too much here, but we are going to talk a lot about the mechanisms that control whether or not that signal gets on or off or shut down. Right. So what we realize then is, again, the cellular mechanisms determine performance, but your plasticity or your adaptability is determined by the molecular environment. So here, initially, we've got explanation for several things. Number one, why is it you jump higher than I jump, and we both never exercised? Okay, you're functioning different at the cellular level. You just contract with more velocity. But why is it when we go on the same training program, I recover faster? Or you need more volume, or you're not responding to the same workout, I got to do a different one. Well, those are probably, we think at least, partially explained by you have different things going on at the molecular level. So maybe you've got more of these proteins, or your proteins are more sensitive, or something like that. And that's what I mean when I say your plasticity is a result of your molecular environment. Right? Now, I'm stretching that explanation just a little bit, but I think it highlights the concept. Right? We got a lot of work in this area to know exactly what's going on. But I think I'll show you some data that are fairly convincing that we're on the right track. So one of the first studies we wanted to design was say, okay, you know what, I love the sport of weightlifting. I'm really interested in it. And one of the things I realize is when you train like a weightlifter, you get a completely different physical adaptation than if you were to train like a bodybuilder or a powerlifter. And so let's look at the molecular mechanisms of that to see if that's actually true. And so we said, okay, let's do a classic, by the way, what a phenomenal looking subject. Great technique. Look at that extension. Just anyways, that's Dr. Bagley. Just kidding. Just kidding. And so we said, all right, let's take a classic weightlifting workout, 15 sets of three at 85% of a clean and pull. We'll do a biopsy before we start. We'll do half of the sets, eight sets, do a biopsy again, do the rest of the sets, do another biopsy. And let's compare that to something that's almost the same volume, but is a more of a classic hypertrophic bodybuilding, regular gym goer, three sets of 10, ACSM guidelines, standard workout, right? And so we decided to look at three particular proteins. These are those signaling proteins. That's your cell wall again. We decided to look at one called ERK, which is responsible for, or it's involved in growth. One called P38, which is involved in the inflammatory response. And one called JNK, which is a stress-responding protein. Now, pay attention to P38, because Dr. Tobias is going to come back to a similar protein later. But the point is, we wanted one in the growth relation, the growth family, one in the inflammatory, and one in the stress family. Well, what we found was pretty clearly, we saw a threefold or higher increase in the activation of these proteins in response to our 15 sets of three. So it definitely did it. But when we compared that to previous studies that had done more of your three sets of 10, they saw more like tenfold. So now, practitioners, let me ask you, if I did both these workouts, which one of these would stimulate more muscle growth? Easy, 3x10, right? You all know that. We've known that since the 40s, or probably long before, right? But we never understood why. If you do 15x3, you're going to put on some muscle mass, but not nearly as much as you'd put on as something like that. So now we have a molecular explanation for something strength and conditioning coaches have known for decades. So we're able to say, hey, look, if the coach says do 15x3, and you go, you know what, I'm short on time, I got to get home to watch The Bachelor tonight. Tasha watches that and it kills me. Can I just do 3x15? It's the same thing. 45 is 45, right? Reps are the same. No. No, you can't. Like, you will take your rest and you will do all 15 sets of that. Because that's a totally different response. It matters. I'm just going to go to the gym. I'll just figure it out. How many are you going to do? I don't know. Like, whatever until I get tired? No. You wonder why you don't get the results you want. Every time I lift, I get bulked up way so fast. Really? Well, maybe take a second to figure out how you're training, because that probably has a large part of explaining why you're getting the adaptation you don't want or missing the one you want. Well, let's take this to the chronic level. So let's look at what happens over time. And so, again, following our theme, I want to look at two types of training that are even closer together. So this is short-term overtraining, which is about 14 straight days of squatting. In one of the studies, we did 10 sets of one at 100% of your squat max. So you do 100% of one rep max, take a break, and you do 10 of those. And if you miss one, you do it again until you get 10 successful. And you do that every day for 14 days. So it's short-term overtraining. Well, this is that ERK protein, and I don't even care that you understand what's exactly happening here. But look what happened from baseline. The total amount of that protein goes way up, but the amount that's activated that you see in the hash goes way down. But when we compared that to a similar training program, which was instead of heavy, it was high power overtraining, so we used more power training to induce it, we saw that. So this is the power overtraining, and this is the intensity one. In this particular case, the amount activated goes way up, but the total amount of the protein that you had goes way down, meaning your cells literally killed off some of those proteins, saying, we've got too many around here. I don't have the foggiest idea why, or what this means. All I know is we have a very clear differentiation at the molecular level with different types of training. We've got a lot of work to do to figure out what this means or how you could change your training program. But at least it shows us pretty cool stuff. And I get to make people squat every day really heavy. And it's science. And so we've got the same basic idea down here, right? Well, this led us to believe there's got to be a direct relationship here. Perhaps the molecular stuff is causing the cellular adaptations. In other words, the cellular environment you have creates the change, or sorry, the molecular environment you have creates the change at the cellular level, which is kind of a fancy way of saying perhaps there are fiber type specific molecular differences. And so we came back, did another study, and said, let's look at that P38. Remember that protein? Well, we know that it increases things like mitochondria, and it can cause a fast to slow fiber type transformation. And so we looked at it in a fiber type specific fashion. And so we said, okay, how much P38 exists in slow fibers compared to fast fibers? And you can obviously see, I don't know how well you can see those Western blots, but you can see the bar graph, right? Considerably more. Now, did that just fool somebody? If this thing caused an increase in mitochondria and it caused a fast to slow conversion, shouldn't there be more of this in the slow fibers? Well, the particular subject from the study was an endurance-only trained athlete. Distance runner, distance swimmer, distance cyclist. So we don't know exactly what's happening, but perhaps all of his endurance training was causing the P38 to be upregulated in the fast fibers so that they could be converted into slow. Complete speculation, but interesting nonetheless, right? And so then we started to go back to this concurrent training question, and we're fortunate enough to know some athletes that are doing some pretty amazing things in the strength, speed, and power spectrum of performance, competing at the world level or higher, winning events, and in the same week or a week later, winning or placing very high in extreme endurance competition. Which is something you're not supposed to be able to do, right? You're not supposed to be able to go to the American Open, place in weightlifting, and then next week get second in a marathon. Right? But people are doing this now. And we have these sports that are mixing these training modalities into one. You got to lift heavy and you got to get really tired. And it just makes us go like, boy, I know we taught you this in ex-phys class, but somehow it's happening. It's not supposed to work that way, but it's being done. In fact, hopefully all of you have read Dr. Bagley's concurrent training paper, and he showed a similar thing, right? And he kind of came out and it got a lot of press because he's like, wait a minute, I think this idea that all endurance training blocks all your muscle adaptations, I think we need to rethink that. We're not seeing it in the literature, we're not seeing it scientifically, and we're not seeing it in the gym. There is something there. We clearly, you're never going to see a two-hour marathoner squat 700 pounds, like probably not having that happen. But something in the middle, right? And so we said, all right, perhaps we can explain this strong and fit thing at the cellular level. So let's dive into that a little bit harder. Right? So if we go back to our conclusions, we add a third one. The molecular environment is fiber type specific, and we think there may be a molecule or two that can help us understand this strong and fit concept. Right now, just to be clear, and I don't want to oversell it, there's not a single magic pill molecule that explains all of it. But we're on to one that we think is very exciting, is the easiest way I can say it. So Dr. Tobias will walk you into that a little while. So that's my portion of it. I want to thank you all for your attention. I want to thank Dr. Bagley, of course, for the invitation and for getting my lab going in large part. Dr. Tobias for being, as I like to say, the most overqualified postdoc in the country, probably the world. Jose Arevalo, Ryan McManus, Katie Bathgate, all the rest of my phenomenal grad students that are there. Lee Brown, my colleague, mentor at Cal State Fullerton. And then, of course, the guy that got me into this, the barbell boot himself. So I think we're going to take a short intermission. Is that right, Dr. Bagley? 5 minutes, grab more chips, cookies, and... we'll come back for Dr. Tobias.
Welcome back. All right, so our next speaker is Dr. Irene Tobias. Dr. Tobias has a BS in materials science and engineering and a master's of engineering in biomedical engineering from MIT. That's a lot of engineers. I'm glad I got that out of the way. She also holds a PhD in biomedical sciences from UCSD, focusing on biochemistry of cell signaling pathways. Her research has kind of taken her through all different areas, looking at biomaterials, drug delivery devices, pharmaceuticals, and formulations for anti-cancer drugs, but she recently sort of found her niche working with Dr. Galpin. And that's not easy to sort of understand. It sounds awesome, everything that he said so far. So she's currently doing a postdoctoral research with Dr. Galpin. She first heard of him on one of his Barbell Shrugs podcasts, and from there sort of initiated the conversation and now is in her lab. She's passionately and intellectually curious to better understand the epigenetic and metabolic adaptations to elite level performance. When she's not in the lab doing research, she trains regularly at CrossFit style at CrossFit Invictus, and she competes in both short distance triathlons and powerlifting competitions. So we'll give it up for Dr. Irene Tobias. And now it's yours.
Well, thank you, Taylor, for that very kind introduction. I gotta say, it's kind of a tall order to follow up a talk given by the one and only famous Dr. Andy Galpin, but I'm gonna try my best here. This is much more exciting than my PhD dissertation defense. In any case, so again, we've got the cellular and molecular boundaries of muscle human performance is our title here. But what I'm gonna be focusing on is one particular molecule. It's called AMPK, and it's recently been found or shown to have some very interesting fiber type specific differences. And we ultimately think that it may be one of these key molecules that's able to, you know, potentially answer some of these questions about the training implications of how these elite athletes are being able to do these incredible feats of human physical performance. Okay, so again, coming from my background, I know Taylor said a bunch of different engineering this or that. Over the past 10 years, I've kind of dabbled in a bunch of different scientific fields. I mean, it's kind of, you know, pick and choose and see what's out there. But overall, I've definitely found that the most exciting, fascinating science out there happens when you get the convergence of two scientific fields coming together. So for me, in my undergrad, which was material science, but it was actually more at the interface with biology, I really found that that was bringing out some of the most, you know, intriguing, groundbreaking applications, you know. And you'd get things like biomaterials, so for human joint replacements. You get tissue engineering, you know, reconstructing things that have been broken down. I worked for a while on drug delivery devices, so the idea is that you have these problems with old drugs and you deliver them in new innovative ways. And then there's like really crazy, mind-blowing, outlandish things out there. So there's one professor who's actually engineering batteries out of viruses. Incredible. You'd never think to do something like that. But it happens when you converge two scientific fields together. So at this point in my scientific career, I find myself at another convergence, a very exciting convergence of two fields, that of biochemistry with exercise physiology. And it's really cool for me because, I mean, this is where I came from in my PhD, the land of molecules. And then outside of the lab, I always enjoyed, you know, fitness activities, lifting heavy things, all the things you guys enjoy. And I was always really inspired by what elite athletes are doing. That's usually what's on my YouTube in some way, shape, or form. But it's really cool to finally marry these two things together and actually start to be like, hey, what's actually going on in these people at the molecular level? What's different about them? And what is this thing about their training that's leading to that? And for me, that's really exciting in particular because everyone else from my field back here, you know, in grad school, traditional biomedical biochemistry research, everything is being applied to the study of disease. That's generally where all the funding comes from. That's, you know, it should be where the majority of our focus is, should be to improve human health. But the thing that's really exciting is that nobody's really looking at the other end of the health spectrum. Nobody's really researching people that are really pushing the boundaries of physical performance, these elite human athletes. And Dr. Galpin, I've got to say, is probably uniquely positioned as, I think, the only investigator in the world that can really go after these questions. Because not does he only have the scientific expertise, the ability to do muscle biopsies, all of this muscle physiology knowledge, but he also has the connections to these athletes, which really no other researcher out there has, these concurrently trained athletes. So it's really exciting for me to be able to work with him. Okay, so I always have to put this slide in because everybody likes it. It might help you understand a bit more about the nut that I am. But indeed, like everyone in grad school, I did some thesis research, I did some lab work, I published some papers that nobody is ever going to read. But let's be honest, I really think my best contributions to the field, to science in grad school, were my Halloween costume. So this slide is also to adjust your eyes from the different color scheme in Dr. Galpin's talk to the more colorful one in mine. But yeah, so our lab studied molecules, so I dressed up as various molecules that we studied, a virus that I had to work with in the hood all the time. So, you know, connected it with powerlifting somehow, I don't know. But really, you know, what you find in science, is, on the one hand, it's a very exhilarating, a very rewarding thing to be pursuing. But a lot of the time, it can also be extremely frustrating and often quite soul crushing. So along the road, you have to keep a sense of humor about things, and you gotta also find the things that sort of work with your personality to keep you going when things get rough. Okay, so proteins. We can dress up as them, we can make, you know, design headdresses and stuff, but what really are they? You know, and I think a lot of people kind of outside our field, when they think of protein, they think of the proteins we eat, nutrients, food, supplements, that sort of thing. And yeah, that's true, that's all protein. But what's almost more important and interesting are the proteins that our body makes. So these very complex molecules that are ultimately powering, regulating all of the physiological processes that we perform as humans. So, I mean, a lot of people know about DNA, that's really important, that's, you know, where you store all your genetic information. But DNA is pretty much information. It's the protein that really acts on that information. So these are incredibly interesting molecules to study. There's about 20,000 of them in the human genome. So many to choose from, you know, just endless stuff to go after in this particular field. So, okay, in grad school and also now, I have specialized in a certain family of proteins. They're enzymes, so enzymes are proteins that perform chemical reactions. They actually do work, essentially. And this class of enzymes are called protein kinases. So the word kinase is from the Greek word, it means to move. And they are key players in the process that we call cell signaling. So Dr. Galpin touched on that a bit, P38, you know, and that kind of thing. And cell signaling is really how do proteins communicate with each other within the cell to take an input and produce an output. Okay, so whenever I draw a kinase, I always represent it as a Pac-Man. Some other people in the research do, but it kind of helps you understand in the illustration where is the kinase, the active, the part of the kinase that's doing work. So what do they actually do? Well, the reaction is they take ATP, which you may know of as our cellular energy currency, and they cleave this third phosphate group off, and then they transfer it to another protein, which we call the substrate. And the substrate is basically the target of that enzyme. And a lot of times with kinases, this works as an on-off switch. So they can either turn on the activity of that protein, or they can turn it off, and I'll show some examples today of that. And that's ultimately why they're, you know, these key communicators, and you'll have one kinase communicating to one, to another, and downstream, downstream, so on and so on, which creates what they call a cascade. And it's also important to note that kinases, pretty much a lot of the time, will get phosphorylated themselves. Phosphorylated is to add the phosphate. And that is often very key to regulating their activity. Now, why do we care about kinases? Well, they're very important to physiological processes. Things that we all care about, like cell growth, metabolism, energy storage, and gains, let's be honest here. But then on the other hand, kinases often become mutated, misregulated, and this is what makes bad things happen. And it's not too surprising then why a majority of the drugs, definitely the cancer drugs that are in development today, are specifically designed to target kinases and turn them off, so the ones that are gone bad. But again, we're not studying disease, as we mentioned before. We're more interested in kinases when they're working at their most optimal level, you know, in terms of health. And so again, a big focus is how exercise regulates a kinase for us and then goes on to produce all these outputs. And now here we're connecting biochemistry with exercise physiology. Pretty cool. Okay, so you finish your PhD, now the world is your oyster. You can study whatever you want. So you pick which kinase you want. I got kind of stuck studying this kinase that I'd say was a lazy kinase in grad school. If I had to sum up my thesis dissertation in a few words, it would be PKC zeta was a lazy kinase. So I was kind of tired of that. And I was like, I'm going to study a kinase that does something really, really cool. And AMPK is ultimately, if you were to pick an enzyme in the body that is the most tied to exercise, this would be it. It has been shown repeatedly to be activated by exercise. And it is ultimately this master metabolic regulator of tons of different cell processes. Short-term stuff, like how you manage your energy, you know, and then long-term stuff, how you turn on gene expression programs. And it's also, as we mentioned, has some very fiber type specific interesting properties. If you want to know the real name, it's down there, but we don't have to worry about that. So yeah, I am indeed one of those scientists when you find a certain topic intellectually stimulating, you call that sexy. It's a typical term. All right, so I'm not the only one who's interested in AMPK. Actually, turns out it's one of the most hotly studied enzymes out there because it is really, really cool. But it has a broad range of interests and applications. So for example, from a clinical standpoint, there's this drug called metformin. So it's been used since the 50s to treat type 2 diabetes. Like a lot of old drugs, it has the issue where, okay, they know that it works, but they don't know how it works. And so it was more recently shown that metformin actually activates AMPK, which kind of makes sense, you know? And now they think, okay, this is like one of the mechanisms that explains how it works. And you think, well, what really would be the most effective treatment for type 2 diabetes out there? Exercise. So tying it in with AMPK starts to make sense. Now, there's this other drug which was designed a little bit more recently, specifically to activate AMPK. This one's called ICAR. And there was this really interesting study done about 10 years ago in the Salk Institute near San Diego, where essentially they took these mice, these sedentary, untrained mice, and they treated them with ICAR. And the ones that were treated with ICAR had a 44% increase in their endurance than the untreated mice. This study got picked up. It was published in the journal Cell, which was kind of prestigious and all panned out to all these news sources. And what ultimately resulted from it was ICAR became declared a performance-enhancing drug and is now pretty much on all the lists of banned substances for competitions. So really interesting implications of AMPK here for human performance. Okay, so I have to do this slide. This is kind of where I geek out on molecular mechanisms of activating kinases, and I'll try and break it down and explain it as best I can, but I like to do it because they make fun animations and colors and stuff. So AMPK is actually, it's not one protein. It's a combination of three proteins that come together. They're each expressed by a different gene. And then once they get made, they find each other in the cell and they stick together because they ultimately need each of the parts of it to actually work. And so we call these different parts subunits. And the whole thing is a heterotrimer. Okay, so what do each part do? So they all have Greek letters. Scientists have something that they like about Greek letters. any rate, so the alpha subunit is what we call the catalytic part of the enzyme. So this is where it actually does the chemical reaction and to transfer a phosphate to another protein. The beta subunit is responsible for something we call scaffolding interaction. So this is where a protein binds to another protein or to another molecule. And in the case of AMPK, it binds glycogen, which is the long chain form of glucose that we use as our major energy storage. Now, the gamma subunit is what we call the regulatory part of the enzyme. So this is kind of the control center. It kind of decides, okay, are we on? Are we off? You know, what are we going to do right now? And it responds to a stimulus. So AMPK, the mechanism is really cool. So when you exercise, you start using up your ATP. You need energy. And so ATP gets broken down into these two other molecules, AMP and ADP, the single and the diphosphate form of the triple phosphate form. And so these two molecules actually bind to AMPK at the regulatory subunit. And this causes a conformational shift in the enzyme, which ultimately results in phosphorylation, increased phosphorylation of the alpha subunit. Again, this is a kinase that needs that phosphate to be turned on. And now it can go signal to downstream substrates and phosphorylate them. Now, to make it a little more complicated, not only do we have these three different subunits, but there are also multiple different versions of each subunit, each made by different genes, again. And we call these isoforms, these different versions. So there are two for the alpha, two for the beta, and three for the gamma. And while they all make AMPK, they perform similar functions, they each have different properties. Some of them may bind better to glycogen. Some of them may be more activatable. And again, these are ultimately regulated by genes. This could be something that's changing with, you know, your training or things that you're doing, your epigenetics. So, and again, they can form different combinations of heterotrimers. So there's multiple different things that could be going on here and certain combinations that could be expressed in some cells, but not in others. Okay, so what are the targets of AMPK? Why is it this master metabolic regulator? What's known about that? So there are tons of targets of AMPK, but I'll be going over some of the most prominent ones. So there's this enzyme called acetyl-CoA-carboxylase, ACC. Now this enzyme is responsible for the production of fatty acids, so one of our methods of energy storage. AMPK actually, when it phosphorylates ACC, it's a negative regulatory site, so it turns off that enzyme. And what happens is that we turn off that production process, now we turn on the breakdown process. A similar thing happens with glycogen synthase, which is the enzyme responsible for producing glycogen out of glucose subunits. Again, this phosphorylation by AMPK turns it off, and now we can start breaking down glycogen. So there's a common theme with this enzyme that it ultimately turns off processes that use energy, that consume energy, and turns on processes that generate energy. The cell is essentially saying, oh no, we need more ATP fast. What are we going to do? Now, two other substrates, which I think are really cool and ultimately have some interesting training implications and explain some things people may have been wondering about. I will say off the start, they have the worst names I have ever come across in molecular biology. Seriously, some of these people are terrible with names they do. I'm not even going to read it. It's terrible. But TBC1D1 and TBC1D4. So when they get phosphorylated by AMPK, this turns them on. And what ultimately happens is that they turn on glucose uptake. So what's going on here is this. Any of you that listen to Barbell Shrugged, the window of gains, pretty cool. This is, you know, this is that post-workout period where everyone is drinking their protein shakes. Everyone's like, okay, this is the time we need to fuel and get our gains and all these sorts of things. Well, what's happened essentially is AMPK has turned on your glucose uptake, specifically in your muscle cells where you've been working out. And now you're more primed to respond and ingest those nutrients into your muscle cells where you want them, and not so much in your fat. So interesting stuff there. And ultimately, I petition that we change the name of these proteins. It's terrible. We should now call them the window of gains proteins. Yeah. All right. So how do we actually measure how AMPK gets activated in the lab? What do we do? Well, our primary readout is these things called blots, which are used to quantify proteins. And they're actually pretty simple to read. If you get similar intensity of bands, you got equal amounts of proteins. If you see one more intense than the other, then they're different. What's really cool to me, especially joining Dr. Galpin's lab, is every time I looked at these blots in grad school, it was always coming from something like a mutant cell culture. Human cells that have 82 chromosomes. How human is that? I don't know. Or mice, or rats, or green monkey kidney cells, or Chinese hamster ovary cells. How is that physiologically relevant? Well, now, when we see blots, this is human muscle fibers. These are real people that are walking around still today. Pretty cool. And we can look at them in comparison between resting states or after they've exercised, things they have actually physiologically done, not just drugs. And what we measure here is typically the ratio of a phosphorylated protein over a total protein. So what that means, for example, in the case of AMPK alpha, the catalytic subunit, which has a phosphate, do you take the ratio of the phosphorylated form over the phosphorylated plus the non-phosphorylated form? And we can do the same measurement for all of these different substrates that we're interested in. It'll look pretty similar. Now, AMPK, it's been hotly researched, as I mentioned. Actually, over almost 20 years, people have been taking human muscle biopsies and looking at AMPK. You know, tons of papers out there. But what all of them have not done is they haven't separated out the fiber types. They have done what we call whole muscle studies, where it's mixed fibers. They don't even care. They don't say, you know, they have disregard for slow twitch versus fast twitch. Now, from Dr. Galpin's talk, you probably gathered that slow twitch and fast twitch fibers have very different metabolic properties. For something like AMPK, which is this master metabolic regulator, doesn't it make sense to study it in a fiber type specific manner? So then here we are asking this question, does it act differently in these different fiber types? And I will have to apologize that I chose a different color scheme to represent the fiber types. I never took that class where you had the red or the white fiber or whatever. And I did it in blue, and unfortunately, the white one is the slow twitch fail here. It's really because I do hate it when you put red and pink next to each other. Can't stand it. No, I like dark blue and light blue. Okay, but we're familiar with all these names here. You got the slow twitch, the fast twitch, and the fibrins. And then we see all the AMPK isoforms, the seven sisters of AMPK, or whatever you want to call them. Well, then we could ask the question, what if the slow twitch fiber has one collection of AMPK that it prefers to express, and then the fast twitch fiber might actually have a different collection? This could be responding to your training, and it could be different for different athlete populations. Well, there's this one brilliant paper published 2 years ago that finally recognized we need to do this. We need to do fiber type specific studies. And the results that they found was that the beta 1 isoform was much more prominent in the slow twitch fibers, whereas the gamma 3 was in the fast twitch as well as one of the window of gains substrates, more preferable there. Whereas the other guys were actually roughly equivalent between them. So they did a ton of awesome things in this paper, but there were a couple things they didn't look at. One thing was the gamma 2 isoform. So this one's actually interesting to me because I read some, you know, more traditional biochemistry experiments where they do things in test tubes. And they actually compared the proteins, and the gamma 2 is known to be the most activatable. So it responds to AMP at the highest level and produces the greatest activity. hey, what if some of these elite athletes are starting to make more gamma too? I mean, that would be super interesting. And what is it like in different fiber types? Another thing they didn't look at were the hybrid fibers. And ultimately, most of the labs out there do not have Dr. Galpin's sophisticated way of sorting out the fiber types, so they kind of ignore the hybrids. But they're important, you know? Okay, so why haven't labs been doing fiber type specific studies? Why has it all been whole muscle? Well, it turns out because the methods tend out to be a lot more challenging and difficult and time consuming and aggravating. So I'll describe it for you here. So a lot of people have had to do, Dr. Galpin himself included, probably had a nasty time in grad school doing something called fiber pooling. So here, again, we have our mixture of all the fiber types. And so you isolate them, as we commonly do, but then you have to cut them in half. So half of that fiber goes to be dissolved and used for fiber typing analysis, which is standard. That's fine. No problem doing that. But then we have to save the other half of the fiber intact, put it out in a 96-well plate, each individual one there. And then when we identify which type is which, we have to go back to that plate, we have to scoop them out, and then we have to combine them together in pools of roughly 20 fibers just to get enough AMPK protein to analyze. And this is really because the MHC protein Dr. Galpin talked about, there's a ton of that in the muscle fibers. But a more specialized cell signaling protein such as AMPK is at lower levels. And so here, you know, you get a pool of fast twitch, a pool of slow twitch, and this is one sample. So you have to do that again and again to get enough statistics. And since your hybrid fibers, you know, are in a lower percentage of your overall fiber type, it's hard to get enough of those. So the study of them is ultimately kind of not feasible. What would be much better if we had single fiber methods? This would make our lives much easier. So here, we could isolate the fibers. They all stay in one sample. We dissolve them. And then one part goes to the fiber typing, and then the rest of it is all there ready for us to use for the AMPK analysis. That what this requires is a method for us to detect AMPK at those lower amounts of protein present in a single fiber. Okay, so why have we been so limited by this? Well, here we come to the story of this very archaic, horrible technique. It's widespread around the world. Every biochemistry lab in the world does it. Every biochemist has done this at some point. Dr. Galpin did it in grad school. It's the standard way to measure and quantify proteins. So I'm not going to go into all the steps. It's called Western blotting. It's terrible. You have to make all these different, you know, gels, blots, chemicals, electric transfers, and then it's goes on and on. You have to do these different rinsing steps. They have to go overnight in these antibodies, more rinsing, secondary antibodies. Then you go in the dark room and you have more chemicals and you have this detector and everything. Very involved process, very time consuming, aggravating. And you would think after all that hard work, you know, after following all the methods to a T, doing everything right, you would get some nice looking results, you know, to make your day better. Well, you can go through 5 years of PhD, you know, grad school, okay, I did Western blots every single day. I come back, you know, and you will still get things that look like this. This is a blot of mine from the fall. I did all the procedures correctly. And it's not just me. This is a problem for everybody around the world. Western blots are kind of hated. And it's such a widespread problem, we have internet memes to describe our frustrations with this horrible, archaic technique. Yeah. And, I mean, the good even aren't all that good. But, yeah. Okay, so, well, we still did some Western blots because we wanted to try and replicate these really interesting results looking at the subunit fiber type specific differences. So, I went through the process of pooling the fibers. We have the slow twitch, the fast twitch, and then here to see that the single fiber, we're getting nothing there. But we were getting some promising results. We saw the beta 1 isoform, again, Western blots, of course, the part of the blot you're most interested in. This is where you get the dirty stuff happening every time. But we can see that there's less of that band there, and then there's less of it there. So that's replicating the result. AMP gamma 3 was actually kind of more equivalent. So this was a bit different than the result. This was a female subject, myself, versus some men. So there could be some differences there. We don't know. And gamma 2, I can't completely know for sure if that's the correct band, but we were seeing some interesting results here that maybe it's more preferred in the slow twitch. But ultimately, this is one experiment. This is the one that I got the best looking blots for. And this needs to be replicated, this needs to be reproduced so we can be sure of these results. And we're just getting very limited by this archaic technique. So I put this picture here. The question is, what does a Western blot have in common with a Walkman? They were both invented in the same year, 1979. Are we walking around with Walkmans anymore? No. Should we be doing Western blots? It's 2017. So, you know, you have this problem. You want to solve it. You're still an engineer at heart. And you're sick and tired of doing Western blots. You don't want to do anymore. You got a PhD. You shouldn't have to do that anymore. So what do? You talk to your friends. Your friends who are engineers, entrepreneurs here in the Bay Area. So my friend Kelly, who got her PhD in bioengineering, we were talking and musing together about vacation plans and climbing mountains and stuff. And I was sort of like, Kelly, when is that ultimate fantasy of that Western blotting machine, that automated one that does everything for you? When is that coming around? Like, we need that now. I'm sick and tired of this. She says, well, Irene, actually, it turns out that my startup company got sold recently to this new company that is doing just that. It's not actually a fantasy, it is real. So this is the company, it's right here in San Jose, Protein Simple. And the technique they call is capillary nanoimmunoassay, or the commercial term, Simple Western. It does a lot of the same principles of a Western, but what it does, the capillary part, and you may not be able to see them very well here, but that's part of how they work, is because they're these thin, tiny little capillary tubes that suck up your sample automatically and concentrate it to a very small level where you can actually detect the proteins at lower amounts. And now you can put this cute, sexy little capillary cartridge into this machine. You pipette your plate. I mean, that's not too bad. It's much better than running a Western blot. And then you close the door, and you push start, and you walk away, and it does it all for you. And what do you get at the end of that? This is awesome. This is sexy. This is just what you dream about every night. And you didn't really have to do anything. So we got in touch with this company, and we sent them some of our muscle fibers, actually my muscle fibers specifically. This was kind of exciting. And we were like, okay, run them on this machine. What do we get? Let's look at one of our AMPKs. So we looked at beta 2. This is what we got. So they took a pooled fiber sample, and they diluted it down to approximate the single fiber level. We're detecting that just fine there. And look at that beautiful linearity. It just turns you on, right? And then not only that, they can represent this now as what we call a chromatogram. So this is far more quantitative than a frickin' blot, where literally people are just like drawing little boxes around these bands that are these different like blobby looking things. And then they use like Adobe Photoshop or ImageJ to be like, oh, how intense is that? No. This thing leaves out that subjective point to it. And that's our single fiber level. We started looking at some of the other AMPK isoforms. They look great too. Just as a comparison to remind you what we were coming from, this is the same protein that we're looking at here with the same detection antibody. Totally different. And ultimately, this saves us so much time. You put this thing takes 3 hours. Automatic, you come back. It does the data. The other thing takes 2 days. Now we can use our time for more important things like training for powerlifting meets. Let's be honest here. No more of that. No more Western blotting. I'm done with that. So yeah, we got one. And now we can ask more exciting questions about AMPK and different fiber types, like how does it activate differently? And now we get to bring in this thing, this evil thing from exercise science. And ask also interesting questions like, what about the effects of high-intensity interval training? So I think we've all known that intense intervals typically get people better results, you know? That has a different metabolic profile than a continuous training program at the same, you know, same time. So this brilliant paper I mentioned before also looked at this. This is why it was super amazing. They looked at its fiber type specific implications of high intensity interval training as well as AMPK. So an example here I'll walk you through is, again, I do the slow twitch in the white and fast twitch in the blue. I didn't know any better. But glycogen, so glycogen is known to be more present in your fast twitch fibers. You have higher reserves of it there. You need to use it really quickly. And then with exercise, it goes down. This was with continuous exercise. When they added in high intensity interval training, here they saw that in the fast twitch fibers, the glycogen levels went even more lower and comparably different with the slow twitch fibers. And then when they looked at activation of AMPK alpha, again, phosphorylated bands here, again, those both go up with exercise. But it was only with the intense interval exercise that we saw a difference between the fiber types, that the fast twitch had even more activated protein. Pretty cool to actually see molecular evidence of how these training programs differ. And they actually showed the same things for these two substrates, the ACC and the TBC1D4. One thing they didn't look at, though, was the time period after exercise, the window of gains. There's exciting stuff going on there, and you're not doing any work. You're kind of resting then. So this gave us the idea, okay, what about taking a time course profile of the activity of this protein, not just before exercise and immediately after? So now we can do an experiment, time for an experiment. This turned out to be, I would say, the most fun experiment I have ever done in my life. So we get my favorite molecule, enzyme, AMPK. Not my favorite training modality, but that's okay. It's still exercise. And then we had time. And so here it is from 2 weeks ago. We did this thing where I took a resting biopsy. Then I did 6 high-intensity intervals on this evil exercise science bike at pretty close to full out for a minute and a half, 40% recovery in between. You know, you got to work for your science. You really care about it. You got to bleed. You got to sweat, all that kind of thing. And then an immediate post-biopsy exercise, just like they did in that paper. But then we took a third biopsy at 30 minutes and a fourth biopsy at 90 minutes. So science not for the faint of heart. But it was super fun. I loved it. So now I'm really excited to start using that new machine, looking at the fiber type specific differences in all the different time points, and then get this cohort of men that's going to be the subjects in our paper. Well, so I just said that, cohort of men. You read these papers, not only do you see that they were done primarily in whole muscle, they didn't separate the fiber types, but another common theme to pretty much all these papers you will read on human muscle biopsies is this. Men, men, male, male, men. How are we actually studying humans if we're just studying men? Really? So this is actually part of a larger problem throughout the biomedical science field. It's been a problem actually from my field originally because it turns out people tend to study male mice and rats far more than they look at female subjects. And, you know, the NIH is trying to now promote that we need to study female subjects more. women. This has been picked up by popular media, that kind of thing. Also, for an example, there have been some clinical trial problems. So Ambien, very popular, you know, drug for sleep, when it was run in clinical trials, it was studied in men. When they actually started releasing it and selling it, they discovered, oh, women actually need to take a lower dosage. Oh, our bad. So, you know, this is important here. And then on our side of things, we're interested in female athletes. Dr. Galpin showed a lot of pictures of women in his talk. We're at this very unique point in human history, I think, where after centuries, we're finally experiencing this cultural shift where women are finally starting to be like, oh, I want to be strong. I want to be fit. I want to do those things. They are finally actually expressing their full physical potential. And we're finally learning, you know, redefining, hey, women actually can lift that much weight. Women can have upper body strength. Women can compete in these intense sports. You know, redefining what we know about them. And, you know, they represent these interesting research subjects as well. Like, how could their physiology, you know, their biomolecular properties be going on and be different than men? And also now they're generating the same fan interest and they're getting paid as much as men in these sports. That's pretty awesome too. It's a pretty exciting time to be alive. So, and then there was indeed one AMPK exercise study that I did find that compared a population of men with a population of women, and they had some really interesting results. So here, look at phosphorylated activated AMPK, and in the men, they saw that they had greater activation of the enzyme with exercise than in the women. Although it could be that the women had higher levels to begin with, so it's not like men are better than women or anything like that. It's just a different, interesting gender-specific difference. However, when they looked at one of the substrates, the ACC one, they actually activated that one to a similar level, or phosphorylated it, actually deactivated in this course. And again, this was whole muscle, this was continuous exercise, but these were really interesting results. But this paper was published 10 years ago, and nobody's actually followed up on it. Why? Why aren't we studying women? It's a big question here. Are scientists really sexist pigs? I don't think so. Well, it's because of this thing. This thing that we all learned about in fifth grade health class called the menstrual cycle. So women have this period of roughly 28 days where they experience fluctuations in hormones. Women are complicated. These two female hormones, estradiol and progesterone. And the problem that worries scientists here is, again, this is an unknown. This is a variability. This could impact your experiments. You know, if what might be going on at different times of the month that could affect your muscle. I mean, again, we know muscle is an endocrine reservoir. It's affected by hormones. There could be some validity here. When you look at that, the methods of that paper, you see this clause here. All the women basically had normal menstrual cycles. They weren't on any birth control. And then they came in during day 7 to day 10. Which is kind of odd why they picked that time point here. I would actually have picked something more at the beginning where your hormones are at your most baseline level. But you can start to imagine, you know, doing human subject studies, which I'm getting into myself, but starting to learn the ropes of that. There's a lot to coordinate. There's a lot of schedules. And women don't always know their periods, and they're unpredictable. So really, the reason we're not studying women is because scientists typically have a horrible habit of going after the lower hanging fruit, the stuff that we can publish more quickly, easily, that's more feasible with less variability, less factors here. Ultimately, men are the lower hanging fruit, literally. So we're charged up about figuring this out. We want to change the paradigm here. We want to actually start studying more women. And unfortunately, I don't have the time today to describe to you some of the things I've learned about AMPK and estradiol, which are really interesting, and also some rather unusual, unconventional methods, should we say, about trying to define that system and whether it actually matters for us. I mean, we can imagine something like fiber type. That's not likely to change with a menstrual cycle. But signaling proteins, we're not so sure. But we want to find that out so we can be like, hey, we actually can biopsy women on any day of the month. Okay, so tying things in here, coming back to the elite athletes, the really cool people that inspire us. So again, these concurrently trained athletes that Dr. Galpin was describing, they are changing our perception of what's possible. They are now combining strength, power, speed, and endurance. How are they doing that? What's going on here? You know? And so we really kind of have this story and this theme of fiber type specific differences being really important. And again, there could be this hypothesis, as Dr. Galpin showed with that elite MMA guy, he had lots of fast twitch. I mean, these guys have got to have lots of fast twitch too to do that, you know, Olympic weightlifting where they generate a lot of force in a small amount of time. But what if their fast twitch fibers are starting to take on the characteristics, the metabolic characteristics of a slow twitch fiber? And AMPK, now that we've seen these fiber type specific differences, this could be something that could help us measure that. Maybe we could see AMPK properties that are typically seen in a slow twitch, now in a fast twitch fiber of these athletes. So we're really excited, you know, to get to that point where we can start studying these people. We kind of have to publish some other stuff first and get our methods along the way and do that stuff. But this is what excites me. This is why, you know, I'm here. You know, and also just to mention, you know, think to the future, 20 years down, you never know where this stuff might go, but applications of your research, maybe we could have a better understanding of this post-exercise, you know, nutrition window, what might be different for some people or not actually matter for others, how to design better training programs, again, like high-intensity intervals, we know those are good, but what might be better for you based on your fiber type, your health status. Also, I didn't mention yet, but AMPK is now hotly interest for the quality of aging aspect. So this kind of makes sense, as exercise generally makes you age better, but people are starting to realize that it has effects on aging. And then also, you know, maybe therapies to help people that are disabled that can't really exercise in the way that we can. Maybe there's stuff we can learn from these elite athletes and their AMPK that could help them. We don't know yet, but it's exciting to go after. So come to the end here. So I really want to thank Dr. Andy Galpin. Like many of you, I became familiar with his work from listening to that most excellent podcast, Barbell Shrugged. And, you know, I'd hear him speak and I'd be like, wow, this guy is brilliant. This exercise physiologist knows a ton about muscle. When they came to interview him at his lab, like, I was like, oh my God, this guy actually takes muscle biopsies and does molecular experiments. All this stuff I learned from grad school. This is starting to sound really cool. So last summer when I had finished my PhD, I was trying to decide what to do next. I was traveling and I was sort of like, do I really want to go work for a pharmaceutical company right now? Do I really want to go back to industry? No, I think I want to go work for this guy I heard on the radio. I think that sounds like way more fun. And he's doing more cool stuff. So yeah, thank you, Andy. It's been really amazing, even just over the past 6 months, to work with somebody that not only shares the same passions that you do, works in a similar style, you know, let's get this done, let's find a way, let's make it happen. But it was also just a lot of fun to work with and has become a good friend of mine. And Jose, he's a former grad student from Andy's lab who's been hanging around. He's a master at dealing with those pesky fibers. I'm terrible at it, but he's like the fiber whisperer and takes care of a lot of that for me. Dr. Jimmy Bagley, he helped us find some of the funding we needed to get this project started in the first place last fall, and this incredible opportunity to talk here. And then also my friend, Dr. Kelly Gardner, I mentioned. She's the one that ultimately told me and clued me into this amazing piece of technology that is ultimately making this project feasible. I probably would have given up if I still had to do Western blots. We wouldn't be going where we are now. So thank you.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Galpin and Dr. Tobias. Again, we do have a few minutes for questions, so if anybody'd like to come up, we've got a microphone.
All right, so I'll start out by saying I'm probably the layest person in the room. I'm friends with Taylor, and I just like to lift. So nice. I literally geek out on, you know, barbell shrugged and a bunch of this other stuff. So I wrote down a few questions. One of the things that sparked my interest at the very end was a lot of the work that the Buck Institute does in Novato on aging and cellular. And I'm an over 40 athlete. I'll be competing in the US Open Series soon and then a jiu-jitsu event following month. So, and that's new for me. I'm a white belt. But I wanted to see if you were going to look at like the impact on conditioning in the muscle fiber. So if Taylor and I, if you know Taylor, he's an endurance athlete. And when it's running, I'm just waiting for a heavy bar when I get inside. So that I can match up, and there's an impact. So I know I need to do more endurance, but I need to understand why. And I wonder if you guys would take a crack at that, if it is actually an impact on my cardiovascular system and those kinds of things, because I'm more fast twitch than endurance.
And then I'll follow up. Yeah. So the first question I would, or the first the way I would answer that is, if you get so tired tying your shoe, like you can't lift well, right? You can't recover. AMPK is one good example of that. That's, as Irene mentioned, it's a metabolic regulator of all energy. And so you're literally talking not only your intraset recovery, but also your ability to recover to train twice in a day and your ability to train again tomorrow. So you've got to have energy pathways that are functioning very well, even if you're a pure strength athlete. When you start going into these 5-minute rolls too, like you're going to feel that big time. Your fiber type is also going to itself probably be changed by the addition of a little bit of endurance exercise, though we don't know. But the real answer to all that is the stuff that she mentioned just briefly, which is the fact that your fast twitch fibers, they can take on in slow twitch fiber properties without actually changing fiber type. And Dr. Bagley could tell you more about this stuff, but it's not uncommon. It's not normal, but it's not completely uncommon to find, say, a fast twitch fiber that has more aerobic metabolism than a slow twitch. It wouldn't be the normal case, but it's theoretically possible. He'll find slow twitch fibers that are bigger than fast twitch or otherwise. So I think one of the things that you have to understand of that is just because you say you're like, I'm a fast twitch guy. Well, you probably are a fast twitch guy because that's how you train. Right. So you do have a lot of plasticity. I don't know if that exactly answered your question, but...
Well, and it didn't help my 13-mile swim I did last May. So, yeah, so I actually, the experiment that came out also, you talked about building of strength, but I was more interested in the building of muscle, and I was more interested in building of strength, because I don't need to build more muscle. I actually just, I'm looking to build more strength, and I wonder, are you looking at the properties of strength on the muscle fiber, not just size? And are they correlated? I mean,
yeah, there's certainly a relationship there. I will say this without question. I personally am far more interested in the strength aspect and the power aspect than the hypertrophy. It's just a little bit more difficult to explain, and it's hard to get a hold of these strength athletes. But what I can tell you is there's only so much I can tell you here, but I'm going to tell you so much, which is that the American Open is in Anaheim next year, as well as world championships.
That's right.
I'm well aware of this.
Biopsies, anybody? Yeah. So nobody else is standing up, so if I can ask one more question.
Yeah.
So Mike Nelson spoke in August in Barbell Shrugged, and I know, but I've listened to the episode 3 times, and for me, as somebody who works several jobs and you know, only gets to train so much time, my diet, and if those don't know, he was talking about metabolic timing and actually eating for your activity. I wondered if you guys have taken that on or if you're going to in the future, because you did talk about nutrition in terms of its impact on cellular production. And so I'll end there, and then I'll just hoard your time afterwards.
Yeah, sure. You want
to add it? With the extra, well, I mean, well, yeah, I think right now we've got a lot on our hands, but but I mean, yeah, definitely nutrition. I mean, you know, Dr. Galpin's an expert at all that sort of thing, and you know, it could definitely be interesting to look at that and fiber type and
Mike's really good. He's a really sharp guy. We're really interested, but that's the difficult part is you can only ask so many questions at once. And until we get a wrap on all this stuff, we probably won't in our lab be doing too much in the near future with that. It's just too complicated.
So you kind of mentioned, my name's Lieber, by the way. We're two students from Chico State who kind of drove down here to see you guys. Now, you kind of mentioned that the slow twitch muscle fibers can kind of develop similar characteristics as the slow twitch. What kind of classifications, like, or characteristics would that be besides like developing more or less mitochondria?
Well, I guess the ones that I mentioned, that was actually kind of more speculation at this point. It's kind of like, you know, forming these hypotheses about what might be going on in these elite athletes who we haven't really looked at, you know, completely yet. I mean, we saw the fiber type thing with the MMA guy, but we haven't started looking at molecular properties yet. So that's kind of down the line, but it's a strong hypothesis. I've talked about it with other, you know, biochemistry scientists, and they're like, yeah, that's reasonable, Irene. I don't know.
What I would say is just about everything can change. You name it, the DNA code is not going to change itself, so the genetics that you have, but all of those functional characteristics, the contractile properties, so in other words, the speed of contraction, the size of the fiber, the latest spacing, so how far this thing is apart, I would be thoroughly convinced that just about all of that can change to some degree. And in fact, I kind of glossed over it, but one of the things that we try to stress when we talk about fiber types is that, yeah, we like to say fast twitch and slow twitch, but the reality of it is all of that's one big-ass continuum. Every property is on a continuum. And so it's really sort of arbitrary to even call one fiber a fast twitch. So, for example, like a hybrid that's half fast, half slow. Well, not necessarily. It might be 95% fast, 5% slow. And then another one might be 80% slow, 20%. And it goes the whole gamut. So, like we were talking about that on the plane this morning. It's like, well, where do you cut off even a hybrid and call it a hybrid? Like, if it's 95% fast and 5% slow, is that actually just fast, or is that slow? Well, like, these are just, you have to arbitrarily draw a line, right? And so what that really highlights you is you don't have this big, here you have this and then you have that. And I would say the same thing would be happening with capillary density, the same thing would be happening with mitochondrial density, all these things. You're gonna have, you know, myonuclei, right? That stuff, right? You're going to see major differences. When you group them together in groups of hundreds of fibers, you probably see characteristics develop. But the individual cell itself, I think, is extremely responsive to everything that you're doing. And so if we biopsied every single person in the room and looked at all these different characteristics of all their individual cells, you would see massive variability. So all of it can change for the most part.
So kind of back to like that contractility or the difference between different fast twitch muscle fibers, there's a lot of talk going around about like true speed training, like training it very submaximally, trying to go as fast as possible. How do you think that changes the, I guess more or less the fast twitch muscle fiber? Because, yep. I mean, essentially, like at the last lecture, professor brought up kind of how even in elder women, when they perform something faster or with more like power, they develop more gains than those who didn't.
Yeah, what you have to understand is two things. Number one, that's actually a strength and conditioning question that we probably can't answer at the fiber type level, and it may not even matter. So what I'm getting at there is when you look at something like absolute speed training, you know that you have to do that on power training on a continuum of the entire force velocity curve. Speed specifically needs to be emphasized at that lower end, which to be maximum velocity, lower force production, right? You have to get there. The question then becomes, how do you actually achieve that physiologically? Well, there's a major neurological component to speed. And so if you go from speed all the way to conditioning on a continuum, what generally happens is more dependence on neurological, equal dependence on neural and connective tissue, and then probably least dependence on neurological most dependence on substrate or energy metabolism. And now that's not entirely true for every single thing, but my point I'm getting at is true speed and power and even strength to a large degree, those are skill. So you need to learn the neural. It's not all neural. Like we, Jimmy and I always laugh, like we're muscle guys. We hate giving credit to neural for anything. Right? It's like all muscle. But we do see changes in things like sarcoplasmic reticulum, calcium affinity, tetraponin, tropomyosin. And I do believe that changes with strength training. We have almost no research at all on true speed training at the single fiber level, like nothing. And so at this point, we'll say like it's probably the biggest concern there is probably at the neural level with that. But yeah, I mean, who knows? The little bit of data that we do have on fast athletes shows their fibers are quite different.
So, thank you.
Hi, really good presentation. Thank you both. My name is Jared, and so my question is sort of just overall, maybe we would like to know, so these concurrently trained athletes, right, that are able to master both, you know, endurance and strength, what's like the recipe, I guess? Are they doing strength and then endurance and then back to strength, or what's the best way to sort of elicit both their fullest potential?
I mean, I think a lot of them are training in all sorts of different ways. You know, they'll do, you know, strength session in the morning or endurance later on, or like go to CrossFit 7 days a week and then run a marathon on Sunday, you know. Yeah. But then
I would say it's a false dilemma. In other words, there is no answer. Sorry. Exactly like Irene said, you're going to have some people that do wildly different things. The fact of the matter is your body doesn't know Monday through is different than Saturday. Like it kind of knows the difference between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. in a lot of regards, but in other regards, it doesn't. So whether you did your strength training Monday night and did your endurance training Tuesday morning or did the opposite, it doesn't really know. So you're going to have to find your own personal balance of what that is, and it depends on what your limitation is. So are you more limited in your endurance or more limited in your strength? Well, if you're more limited in your strength, you should probably prioritize the strength. In general, that's what our answer would be, because you can perform endurance training fatigued because the point is to get tired. You can't perform optimally, especially maximal speed, power, strength, if you're fatigued because you're not going fast. So the general answer to that would be prioritize the strength, speed, power stuff and figure the endurance stuff out. But I would love to say that's actually true, but I know a lot of people that don't, and they get very good. So I would say that if that's your interest, don't worry about that. Get worried about training and figure that out in a year, right? 2 years or whatever. Just go.
Good evening, guys. Dr. Galpin, big fan ever since I saw you on Barbell Shrug.
Likewise.
In fact, I'm such a big fan that I drove from Napa to Martinez to get an Amtrak. From there, I went to Richmond and got a BART, got a Muni. And then because God likes to have fun with me, he made me run in the rain for half a mile.
I think I owe this man a beer.
Wow.
Maybe a burger.
Maybe some new J's, because that's what I ran in. Nah, just kidding. But my question goes more towards programming for tactical athletes such as firefighters, military, and police, because I work for Cal Fire, and what I've noticed is that we're going from more of blue-collar workers to more as tactical athletes, as I mentioned. And what I noticed is that what we do is we do sports in order to train for our job. Yet when we're at work, they require us to do exercise. But it's like at a certain point, you don't want to exercise too much because you may not be ready for what's coming to you. And also, it's we don't get a warm-up, so right. Whatever happens, you know, we just got to be ready. Thank you.
Yeah. No, thank you for coming. Jeez, man. Two questions. Number one, I'll tackle the end of your last statement first. Number one, just like my friend Kelly Starrett, right, down the road, he'll always say, if you can't access it immediately, you don't own it. So you need to develop yourself so that you can get into any of those positions without a warm-up, because you don't really have the mobility or the movement quality if you can't get into it immediately. So that's the first way I'll address it. But that's Kelly. That's not me. The second thing is I'm not even remotely close to an expert in tactical. And so I would point you to the NSCA's tactical meeting. They have an entire national conference for this. They have a journal specifically for tactical training. They've got a bunch of stuff free online and a bunch of other resources. I also have a couple of grad students that are doing their thesis right now on specifically firefighting training manuals. So I'm happy to share those with you if you can email me when they're done. It'll be a few months, but I'll get those to you. And so those are the two resources I would point out to you. And that's the best way I can answer it, because I mean, I can take shots at it. I know a little bit, but those people are experts, so I'll give it them.
How's it going, Dr. Galpin? Cal State Fullerton alumni. Question. Yeah. My name is Johnny. I'm not sure if I mentioned that. But question, are you seeing any difference in activity of AMPK with, like, age differences? Is there, like, a big drop-off?
Yeah, that's a good question. So there's a ton of AMPK papers out there. I'm still, you know, doing my homework on it, ultimately. But yeah, I will say one interesting study with AMPK and aging, which I didn't mention, relative to that drug metformin. So this was actually picked up where they had a population, I think they were in their 60s or something, of diabetics that were taking metformin. And they compared them to similar age people, non-diabetics, not taking metformin. The diabetics were actually living longer, doing better on a lot of health implications because they were on the metformin. And now they're thinking of, because of AMPK was better activated in these people, that might be improving their aging. And they're actually taking, that's actually a big thing, because now people are trying to push anti-aging therapies through the FDA, which are kind of difficult to assess because you're not looking at, like, oh, did they get a disease or not, or did the disease get better? But now they've got that study because it's an old drug, and it's trying to open up ways so that they can study more drugs that basically treat diseases by treating aging is the idea. Yeah.
Hey, how's it going? My name is Milad, undergrad here at SF State. This question is in regards to the myths podcast you did. You guys are talking about creatine, specifically a lot of on how it affects mental acuity. I was wondering if you could kind of elaborate on that, because you didn't really touch on it there.
No. No.
That slide.
I'm not being a jerk, but that's not my expertise. So I just know a little bit of the few papers that I've read on that. And so I can only tell you that there is enough promise in that area for me to feel comfortable to say that in a public forum as like a podcast or a show. But I would really, in respect to the people that do that work, they're the experts, so defer to them. In other words, Google it. There's a lot out there, honestly, on that stuff. PubMed, there's a lot free on that. So the best I can say is it's extremely promising. In a lot of different areas. It's not working for everything, but nothing does. So that's the best I will expand on that.
Well, let's give Dr. Galpin and Tobias another hand. All right. Thank you all for coming. To keep up with us, you can check us out on social media, and we'll keep you posted on the next talk. So thanks, everybody, for coming.